My last question that I like to ask when we look at this text and other ones as well, in Luke 12, 35 through 48, based on 1 Thessalonians as well, is what do you do with this now? What do you do? I would like to know, what do you do? Man, that's just like saying Jesus is the answer. Okay, get ready is right on. Because you see, he wants to, he can, and he will. So therefore, we got to get ready because it's coming. It's coming. We can play a part in probably the greatest revival of all time. All time is if the church gets ready. Act like it. What do you do with this passage? Anybody else?
We put on our boots, we lace them up, and we get suited like our inmates will tell us in prison. We get booted and suited for the fight, we get booted and suited for the gospel.
Amen. I don't think I need to repeat that. Booted and suited. Hang on, I'll get to you. One of the coolest things that I think that the Lord has done for me, you know how like God puts you in places just as a form of encouragement? Our NBA team is the Mavericks. Okay, there's the horse image. Like, I put on boots for that very reason. I got my boots on, and I'm ready to walk. Are you ready? Mike. Get out of your comfort zone. That's what you do with this. You get out of your comfort zone. And there's no snooze button to that. You hear it, you wake up, and you get going. What else do you do with that?
Speak.
Speak to what? Speak to please God. Man, this isn't for you. It's for him and his glory. And as a result, people will come to know him. I love talking about Jesus. There's nothing fun, more fun than to watch somebody's face when you say Jesus. They're like, I'm telling you, it is the weirdest thing. I could be in Seattle, Asheville, Santa Fe, Sedona, Flint, Michigan. We're in Devil's Lake, North Dakota right now. And you still say Jesus, and they're like, they just look at you weird. But when you clearly begin to explain the gospel, and you just walk them through the scriptures, you have them open up the word of God. Scripture says in Hebrews 4, it'll pierce right to their heart. Which means you let God do the work. He just needs people that are ready. God, I'm scared. There's no way I'm talking about Jesus out loud. I'm an intercessor, Kyle. Intercessors have been entrusted with the gospel too.
You're meddling now.
I know. Get ready. What else do you do with this text?
David said to Solomon, he said, be strong and do the work.
You see, I think we're at a stage in history where, yes, we need to ask the Lord to fall afresh on us. Yes, we need the Spirit to pour himself on us. But we also know what the work is. Go. You've been entrusted. Yes, ma'am.
You need to share the word in season and out of season.
Amen.
And we need to be passionate to do that.
Amen. Bottom line is tell people about Jesus and be passionate about it. Amen. Don't overlook any one person. But what I love is that God will still get to that person if you say no. I went to more schooling at Gordon Conwell in Boston and Charlotte, and I flew into Charlotte. And just, have you ever been to a place, you haven't been there in a while, and just memories just flood you? In Charlotte, it's the rocking chairs. And the bathrooms. Do you know that they have bathroom attendants in the Charlotte airport? I'm not trying to be funny. They're ready. When you walk in, they have mints, mouthwash, a little tip jar. And here's the craziest part. They open the stalls for you. That, my friends, is an ultimate picture of ready. Can you delete some of that? But isn't that the truth? It doesn't matter what he's calling you to. It doesn't matter what your giftings are. You just need to walk in them. That's how you get ready. How you share the gospel, that's up to you, but share it in the way that God is asking you to do it. It might be a bathroom attendant. Bless them in the name of Jesus. We're just getting ready. I want to show a video of our team in Seattle this last week, 2 weeks ago, whatever the time frame is. And all we did for a year, and a lot of people have tried to figure out what we do. You see, we get invited to come to a city. It's only by invitation. I believe you're given authority by association. We went to Seattle, Washington. How about this? Because we were in Asheville, North Carolina, and the Seattle Times reporters wrote an article on what we did in Asheville here and published it in the Seattle Times. And the Seattle Times said, we would welcome you because of Jesus. Has anybody ever been to Seattle? That is called a miracle. When we get invited into a city, we then begin to pray. Lord, is this the time in the season for us to walk alongside the church? If we get a yes, we go. And then we spend months getting to know the community, building up the church. Revelation 3:2 was our theme. We want to strengthen the church, strengthen the things that remain, for they're about to die. So we want to strengthen already what exists in the church. 3% of the population of Seattle goes to church. It is one of the deadest areas in all of the United States. We believed our role was to strengthen them. As we get to know the community, we spend seasons of praying and fasting. Folks, I 100% believe that a move of God will not happen unless the body of Christ humbles themselves before the Lord. But when we're asking him, remember what I said, the Capitol Hill Presbyterian pastor? When we're praying and we hear from him, we got to respond then. So as we were praying in Seattle, Lord, what do you want us to do? He started showing, pour into the church. I was like, the church, I'm here for the lost. He says, no, you're not, Kyle. You do what I'm asking you to do. We go before our council, we seek wisdom, we say, yes, we're going to pour into one church, because you see, Seattle's built on seven hills, just like Rome, just like Jerusalem. You get to know your community. So we started pouring into one local church on each hill. And then for months, we came back and we equipped them and we trained them to get ready. And then last week or 2 weeks ago, this is what you'll see, is this is one day, hundreds of volunteers participated in speaking the gospel.
So Lord, may we be so sensitive to the Holy Spirit. And Lord, will you soften hearts, prepare hearts now to hear the truth. And so Lord, we are praying for two things specifically, Lord. Send the laborers with boldness and courage. And Lord, prepare hearts to receive the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, I really believe that Seattle is ready. You are raising up people here, raising up laborers. And so Lord, use us in a way to help further the kingdom of God that will bring glory, honor, and praise to you. And so Lord, I pray that the church steps up, wakes up, and gets going for what you're asking us to do today in Jesus' name.
Thank you. got guys from all over the United States, and the Lord says, come talk to you because you got heaviness. You need to let it go. And you're saying in your rush, which you might be, but in all reality, this is where you need to be.
Oh, I know that. Oh, I understand that completely. Sometimes they don't work now. We have got our
stories, but please tell me what there's to complain about. So there are parts in the Bible that you would say are true, then?
Yeah.
Just...
not every part.
Give me a percentage that you would say, based on Cedric, what would you say?
Ooh. I'll say basically at least, pretty high, at least about 65%.
65%.
Can we pray another time?
Yeah.
Where you going?
But hey, one last thing as you stand there. Sometimes you gotta let it go, brother. See you, Dale.
How's this knee doing? What's going on here?
He's doing a lot better.
Okay, what do we got? What do you feel?
Well, I don't feel the snapping now.
Okay.
For all have seen and fall short of the glory of God.
So do you think that there's anybody perfect in Seattle?
No.
So would you say that we all sin? Everybody?
Yes.
Okay, so this is part of your 65%.
Yeah.
Right?
Are you alright praying again?
Third day. Based on just the things we've read, sin, death, and that he died for us, do you think that's true?
I say yes, absolutely.
Okay, so that's the fourth one. Tell me, what do you think? Do you think it's possible, now that you know Satan doesn't have an option,
yeah,
can that be possible?
Yeah.
This is more strength than ever. Come on in. Fill it up. Fill it up.
God has performed a miracle in you today. That's pretty awesome.
Mostly the term miracle, because like in my whole life, I always believe there would be a miracle if it actually happens to me. A miracle will always happen to people. That's why I actually like this kind of like quote right now. God's performing miracles to me, is like he's performing to save us. He's performing like a path for us to be in the right decision.
He loves you, brother. Please tell me what there's to complain about.
Lord, we revive Seattle. Father, we revive Seattle. Help us. Speak, breathe on us and on this city, these seven hills, in Jesus' name. Amen.
You heard a lot tonight. And I want to pray that as you go back tonight, talk to the Lord about this. I just want you to ask him, am I ready? And then listen for his response. In fact, Josh, can I have you come on up? Can we do this now? And Pastor Tom, can I have you come up? I feel like because you are from Asheville and you pour into this community, I'd like you just to pray before we do this, if that's okay, gentlemen, that our pastor does that. Okay. This is a man who I have walked alongside. And Tom will never tell you this, but in the last year, his church has quadrupled in size in less than a year, folks. Why this is important is because I believe he has taken to heart what it means to get ready. Tom, if you'll lead us in prayer. And then I'll have Sammy, if you would. Thanks.
This song? When he first came here, I was kind of... they left town. They said, okay, you've got the Revive Asheville now. And I said, well, what are we supposed to do? You know, 750 volunteers came in, Texas Baptist men rocked our world. Everybody came out and they left. And they said, you do it. And Kyle said, I said, what am I supposed to do? He said, hit the streets and share the gospel. And I was kind of offended at that. I was like, isn't there another way? And he said, take the wristband and go share the gospel. It works. You cannot minister to a city you do not love. And when you get out on the streets and you hug the homeless and you pray for kids that ride on rail cars all around the country or business people, you start to love them. And I just want to pray for all of you. My heart has been revived. My church has been revived. And it was a matter of getting outside of my comfort zone. The streets every day was not a comfort zone for me, but it is now because we do it every week. And if you'd just like to receive a fresh infilling for your city as I have, maybe just stand up. Let me just pray for you. Would you do that? Anybody just wants to receive that? Just stand up. Because all of you have a heart. You wouldn't be here if you didn't want to change. I just feel like I'm amongst family. From my heart to yours, I just want to ask God to start to give you love for your city. Amen. If you're disgusted with your city, you can't win it to Jesus.
That's right.
You have to love it.
That's right.
In all its mess. So let me just pray. Father, release your goodness to your bride, the church, to begin to love the cities you're calling them to reach. I pray, God, as I walked the streets of Seattle, you kept screaming in my ears, Revelation 3, that the church has become lukewarm, not hot, not cold, that Christ may spew them out of his mouth because they think that they're rich and have need of nothing when they're blind and miserable and naked. And the beginning of revival is a heart of repentance where we realize this is only going to happen if God does it. And I just pray, Jesus, for these people that you love so much who came to this place to seek revival. God, I'm asking that you light a fire of revival in every community that's represented here, every single one. That the people in this room begin to feel not just a head understanding of what it means to love their city, but it begins to burn in their hearts. And they begin to cry and shed tears over the brokenness and the lostness of their city. I ask that you would begin to melt the cold, hard pride of the church in me and in my friends, where we stand aloof from people who look different, act different, and sin. That's what sinners do. And they're just one proclamation of the gospel away, perhaps, of meeting the lover of their souls and spending an eternity with him. And I just pray that the spirit of the Apostle Paul would hit this room right now, and we would be able to say with him, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first and also to the Greek. I just pray for boldness, I pray for faith, and I pray for love, because it doesn't fail. I love you, Jesus. I love what you've done in my city through Kyle and those who have come from all over the country. And I just pray for encouragement for everybody here. If you're really discouraged, just pray for you right now. That God, you'd start to put 1, 2, 3 coals together until a fire starts to burn in their community. And they're already there. I bet they're already there. In fact, I know they're already there. You just got to find each other. God, I thank you for what you're doing. What an honor to get to pray for such an amazing group of people. It is you, Jesus, that's going to save our cities. Help us to get out of the way. Help us to start being bold to proclaim the gospel, because fear is standing, staring many of you right in the face. And God, you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. We glorify you, Reviver. You're the Reviver. You're the Transformer. You're the one with the answer and the specific strategies for each of our cities and churches. And God, we can't find it sitting in our studies reading another book. We have to get out into our cities and cry with them and labor with them and bleed with them. And I just bless you, Jesus, for this place. And I ask that revival fires would turn this tide of decline that we're seeing all across the church until churches are revived and they're the most happening thing going on in all their cities. Better than the NBA basketball teams and NFL teams and college and high school football, that the church is the place to be, because that's where God is. And I pray that in Jesus' name.